Good afternoon, everyone, and a warm welcome to this webinar series. We are doing this in association with the Genetics and Fetal Medicine Committee of FOGSI. And this is a series dedicated to providing education about genetics and an initiative by the chairman of the Genetics and Fetal Medicine Committee, Dr. Mandakini. And the first webinar in this series is on the basics of genetics. So we have a series of 7 webinars lined up over the next couple of weeks. So without any further delay, I will request Dr. Priya Kadam to introduce our convener, Dr. Mandakini, and request her to take this forward. Dr. Priya is the Director of Reproductive Genomics at MedGen.
Thank you, Joseph, and it gives me great pleasure to welcome all of you. Thank you for joining in today. We have a fantastic series of webinars planned over the next few weeks. And it's in association with FOGSI and Dr. Pradhan. So Joseph, can you show me the slide? I mean, Dr. Pradhan as such needs no introduction. She's the professor and head Department of Maternal and Reproductive Health, SGPGI Lucknow. And of course, she's the chairperson of Genetics and Fetal Medicine Society. And we deeply appreciate Dr. Pradhan because she's taken several initiatives to actually spread awareness of genetics and genetic testing amongst the doctor group. And this is one such effort in this direction. So over to you, Dr. Pradhan.
Oh, yes. Thank you, Dr. Priya. And good afternoon, everyone. This is after Human Genome Project. The genetics is fast advancing. And as obstetrician and gynecologist, we are not so well trained in genetics. And probably the genetics will change the practice in every field. That includes medicine, all fields, including our obs-gyne field in next decade to come. So we need to update ourselves in this field so that we can serve the women in a better way. So FOGSI always aims for imparting knowledge, that is the existing knowledge that enhanced it, and the future that is coming up. So in that endeavor, FOGSI Genetics and Fetal Medicine Committee aims to have series of webinar that on genetics. And initially we planned for having a practical approach and then a theoretical approach, but because of COVID that had changed. So now, we have planned a series, almost 7 or 8 webinar, so that we can cover in a systematic and slow way of genetics, which is helpful for obstetrics and gynecology in our field. Not only theoretical knowledge, it is case-based discussion. But today we are fortunate to have our president, FOGSI president, Dr. Santa Kumari ma'am, to grace us and bless us so that we can move forward in this direction. And I welcome to introduce Dr. Santa Kumari. The slide is very, very less. She is our FOGSI president, very, very dynamic. And she is the first lady president of FOGSI. She is treasurer-elect of FIGO. So not only in India, she is into the international arena, and probably she will take FOGSI to the international arena. And so all of us are looking forward for her tenure and take India into that international, so that we can compete with in the international arena. And genetics will definitely help us in moving forward. She was chairperson of ICOG, then secretary Indian College of Obstetricians, then member of FIGO working committee. Lot of work that she is doing. We are blessed that with her, from her busy schedule, she is at least joined with us. Thank you so much, ma'am, and then welcome you, and I welcome you to grace this occasion and bless us with your word of wisdom. Over to ma'am. Yeah.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, Dr. Mandaki Pradhan and Dr. Priya. Yeah, I really appreciate the good work being done by you, Mandakini, for this genetics and committee of FOGSI. Yeah, genetics is always a very intriguing subject. Actually, even I am from my childhood, I still remember genetics is something, you know, we are all really scared of, because it's difficult to understand. So let's hope that you all will make it simple for people like me to be able to understand and implement it in our day-to-day practice. And that is what we need and what we're looking forward to. So wish you all the best and the supporter people also, the educational partners. We really appreciate Medvinom. Very, very well done by you and your team. All the best for all the modules.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for at least while traveling also you are joining, and then we try to make it as simple as possible so that everybody can understand it.
Yeah.
So we will take care of that. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, madam, for those encouraging words. Now, without any further delay, I will introduce our speakers and get the webinar underway. So our first speaker for the day, for the afternoon, is Dr. Hema Purandare, a very senior and respected figure in the field of genetics in India. So she is the founder of the Center for Genetic Medical Genetics, Mumbai, which is now the Medgenome Center for Medical Genetics. So she's done a training in the USA and in the UK on various genetic medical genetics. She's a certified counselor. She established the Center for Genetic Healthcare in Mumbai in 1981 and also started a rural genetic counseling session in Sindhudurg. She's the ex-associate professor at Grant Medical College and a genetic counselor at Nauroji Wadia Hospital in Mumbai. And she's authored multiple books on genetics and her achievements. She's been awarded multiple awards, including the Chaturashtra Chatura by Lok Satta Group, Bharat Jyoti Award by the India International Friendship Society, India Achievers Award for Health Excellence by All India Achievers Foundation, and Wonder Woman by Zydus Notarvia. And she also is a keen social activist. She's taken part in, she's established the Madhav Purandare Rural Computer Institute, and she's also helping farmers with the Himago Organic Mango Industries board. And so welcome Dr. Hema Purandare for this webinar. So our next speaker is Dr. Shagun Agarwal. She's the associate professor for at the Department of Medical Genetics, Nizam Institute of Medical Sciences, and she's also an adjunct scientist at the Center for DNA Fingerprinting and Diagnostics in Hyderabad. So she is credited with discovering novel genes that are causative of human phenotypes, and she also conceptualized and started the MSc Genetic Counseling Program at her host institute. She is also the coordinator for SIMG Clinical Genetics and Fellowship meeting. And she's the executive committee member for the Indian Academy of Medical Genetics and a number of fellowships. And she's also published multiple papers and book chapters, and is also the associate editor for Genetic Update for Next Generation Clinician. And her research interests are in genetics characterization of fetal malformation syndromes. So without any, before we start, I wanted to remind the audience, if you have any questions or comment, please use the Q&A window. We will be sending a recording of this at a later date. So
yeah, can I just say one word? I wanted to say hello to Dr. Hema Purandare and Dr. Shagun Agarwal. I just saw that she happens to be from Hyderabad also. So welcome to both. Dr. Hema, it's very nice to see you after a long time. And Foxy is very happy to associate with all of you all.
Thank you, madam. Thanks.
So I now invite Dr. Hema to start her presentation. Over to you, Dr. Hema.
I think madam is muted, Joseph.
Yeah, maybe you can unmute.
Yeah, it's now.
Yeah.
So for this organizing this wonderful webinar and making your team understand about more about genetics. Now, science of genetics is about 150 years old. Out of that, 50 to 60 years have been a rapid progress. And I'm proud to be part of this particular journey almost for as much as the advanced genetics has happened. Having had thousands of tests introduced after completion of the Human Genome Project, we have been able to offer lot more advanced tests to our patients, and tendency to jump at higher tests is very tempting. But these advances need to be considered carefully hence the importance of this webinar and the eminent speakers who are going to take us through with all the latest tests as well. Now, what we are going to probably learn or not, we should learn at the end of this would be doing right test at the right time with appropriate pre-test and post-test counseling and the importance of pre-test and post-test genetic counseling. So thank you all, and let me start and talk about chromosomes and its testing and diseases. The talk is about chromosome and a history, steps in obtaining chromosomes and prevalence of disorders, types of chromosomal abnormalities, case studies, most favorite of all of us, and hematological malignancy. Now, chromosomes, a book of man in 23 volumes. The chromosomes are fundamental units of heredity with array of genes located on the chromosomes responsible for growth, differentiation, and metabolism of the cell. Our 23 pairs of chromosomes with sex chromosomes, XX in females and XY, can have alteration in number and structure, causing irreversible genetic changes like malformations, syndromes, intellectual deficiency, pregnancy wastage, can be lethal also, and infertility. Sex chromosomal abnormalities have a major role in development and function of reproductive organs and important cause of infertility. And cause of abnormalities is due to error at meiosis, gamete formation, and mitosis that we all know. And advancing maternal age is one of the most important predisposing factors, OVA being in a suspended prophase, resulting in aneuploidies, miscarriages, genetic disorders, and advanced paternal age also is no exception. There is increase in risk of skeletal dysplasia. Now, chromosomal abnormalities in cancer are acquired and is important in diagnosis, prognosis, and to show remission and relapse. And probably cytogenetics is the most important application in hematological malignancies. History of genetic chromosomes, history is very important. We always read the names of the eminent people who have now contributed something to the history. But I always like to pay tribute to people who have not been successful, and because who could not succeed or have their in the plant nuclei. Like Nagel first described thread-like structures in these nuclei, and Waldier defined the term chromosome. Walter Sutton formulated chromosome theory of inheritance and at cellular level by applying Mendelian laws. Of course, now there are so many other people, but for us, cytogenetics is most important. What we remember is Langdon Down, first who appreciated and identified the features of trisomy 21 called as Down syndrome, where the chromosome 21 was also identified. And before that, Tijo and Levan, who first discovered the correct number of 46 chromosomes. Then came Klinefelter syndrome, then 45 Turner syndrome, and Peter Novel was of great importance, showing us Philadelphia chromosome, which is seen in CML, where a lot of treatment and therapy, which I'll come to that the later part of the presentation. It was just not enough to identify the chromosomes, but establishing a normal nomenclature throughout the world of cytogenetics was necessary. And first, a conference at Denver in 1960, there was establishment of human chromosome nomenclature. Then, of course, the Q banding, then Prader-Gall, C banding, Friedrich Sanger, DNA sequencing, interface FISH, then various identification of translocation, as well as it was possible to find out the map the entire chromosome, like it's a colorful picture, which again we will see with some case studies. Next, what we are going to see is about the steps which are obtaining chromosome. Just to know basics very quickly, we require a stimulant for cells to grow. Now, all nucleated cells are suitable for karyotype, commonly used for our lymphocyte, skin, bone marrow, tumor, amniotic fluid, or chorionic cells. The steps include media to growth, stimulation with phytohemagglutinin so that you get dividing cells. It is not required in bone marrows and chorionic villi because these are all short-term cultures. Colchicin to accumulate metaphases, hypotonic to spread them, squashing and making it flattened to have it on the microscope slide after adding fixative, and gypsum and trypsin banding staining. This is how the normal karyotype, which you all are aware of and see in day-to-day practice. The next step is was like bridging the gap, because we wanted quicker report, especially in prenatal diagnosis, when the turnaround time for karyotypes is long, more and more tests, more and more advances had to take place to give a quick answer, especially in prenatal tests. So FISH identifies specific nucleic acid sequences on interface nuclei and as well as metaphase chromosomes. And it provides option for simultaneous detection of one or more nucleic acid sequences using different color label probes. Accurate map of human genome obtained by human genome led to the more and more probes, and more tests are being put into practice. The procedure is again simple. Reporting is also 24 to 48 hours. Major chromosomal aneuploidies, major microdeletions can be detected in a couple of days. Application of specimen to microscope slide, denaturing and addition of the probes, hybridization for 4 hours or overnight, washing the unbound probes, and addition of counter-stain microarray with specific filters, and these are ready to analyze. Now the analysis system, which I told you, was international system of human cytogenetic nomenclature. As you can see, these bands on the chromosome, each band is specific to a particular region, and discrete changes in chromosomal structures was necessary to correlate with the various syndromes what we see. This happened with first with Q banding, and then came our GIMSA banding, GIMSA trypsin. The Human Genome Project opened a new phase of application, and it pioneered the sites where genes were located, which then mutated and caused abnormal structure and function. For example, DMD cystic fibrosis and many others, including cancers. So now we are using it in regular practice. Indications for chromosome analysis are postnatal and prenatal. Prenatal, I'll be talking about it later. But it is at birth, ambiguous genitalia, craniofacial abnormalities, congenital anomalies, intellectual deficiencies. At puberty, short stature, amenorrhea, gynecomastia, developmental defects of secondary sexual characters. And in adults, of course, infertility, repeated pregnancy losses in couples and families, abnormal sperm parameters, oligospermia, azoospermia, morphology, and of course, gamete donors is very important. Prevalence of chromosomal disorders. As an obstetrician, you can see patients right from preconception to adult stage, and knowing what is the percentage of these abnormalities, it is sometimes very astonishing. 10% of spermatozoa, 50% of stimulated ova, 50% of stimulated ova. Probably IVF people need to counsel their patients when these stimulations are used, that such likelihood is there in the progeny or in the conceptors which they will have. Then from zygote to fetus, 50% of all first trimester abortions, 5% of late trimester abortions and stillbirths. In child, or you can say neonatal life, approximately 1 in 160 all live births, and 0.5 to 1% balanced translocation, which is usually a cause of repeated pregnancy loss as well as infertility. Coming next to the, now obstetricians are on the radar, because as I showed you in the previous slide, you have an opportunity to see the patient from right from preconception life to even a woman who is at elder stage, that may include even breast cancer. Everywhere there is genetics which you will have to face, you will have to learn, and you will have to take opinions from. Other systems which are there, like orthopedic or congenital certain disorders of the eye. So they come to the obstetrician first, saying that our child was having like this, or we are having a family history, what should we do next? So these are the things, that is why this webinar is going to be very useful to understand most of the systems also. Multi-system disorders, how they can be handled. Then chromosomal disorder facts are, they are constitutional and lifetime. They affect multiple organ system. Constitutional and lifetime, that means we understand that these are irreversible changes. Frequent hospitalization, high complexity tests, skilled staff is required, major work is manual, and turnaround time of reports is 10 to 15 days for most. Results apply to patient and family. So if there is a family member with a congenital abnormality having a chromosomal factor or a genetic factor, rest of the family members should be counseled. We in the genetic clinics take this opportunity to, when the patient comes for a particular test, to also advise them for the family. Because in a genetic clinic, once the patient gets his report, they never come to you again. They will go to their respective consultants. various reproductive options are open. Earlier date, it was only to adopt a child. Then slowly it went on increasing. Now we have got gamete donors. Earlier it was only sperm. Now it is ovum. So all these people also need, all these donors also need to be screened. Now it involves a lot of ethical, legal, and social issues. Chromosomal disorders, abnormalities are classified as numerical structure. Numerical, structural, autosomal, and sex chromosomal. Numerical, again, all of you are well versed with aneuploidies, triploidies, tetraploidies, mosaics. Structural will be structural abnormality of the chromosome. It can be deletion, ring, duplication, translocation, insertion, isochromosome. Mind you, each one will have a specific phenotype. If the child is affected, it will have a different kind of counseling required if you identify prenatally. A different thing will be required if they are coming to you to plan a pregnancy. So these structural abnormalities are very, very important in the practice of chromosomal studies, in the practice of chromosomal studies. Now, chromosomal abnormalities. Now, autosomal is, of course, Down syndrome, Patau, Edward, Cryo-CAD, Philadelphia, and sex chromosomal Turner syndrome, Klinefelter syndrome, triple X, XYY, 46XX, testicular feminization, and fragile X. Now we will just move ahead and find out. These are the structural abnormalities, how they look like. So you can see the various shapes of the chromosome, some portion being deleted, translocated. It will be given very clearly in your reports, just to give a visual picture. Same is with application of FISH. We all know that in prenatal diagnosis, first place you always ask for a quick aneuploidy screen. The right-hand side below is the colored chromosomes which you see. This was earlier to genome sequencing where we were not able to apply those tests. So if there is any extra chromosomal segment, we are not able to identify to which group it belongs. Becomes very difficult, especially in marker chromosomes. So this was very useful. Then of course, SRY gene studies. Sinclair was the first person who identified this SRY gene. Now, most important application I told you is in hematological malignancies. First to identify was 922 translocation. And this translocation is a fusion gene between BCR and ABL. And of course, activation of tyrosine kinase leading to discovery of inhibiting drug Gleevec, and which is now highly successful treatment for CML. So we are into personalized medicine, and all these advances are going to take you further and go towards the personalized medicine. Chromosome fission microarray, comparative studies, just to tell you that chromosome is, we require cells to culture, so it takes long time for report. FISH will tell you the definite specific region needs prior knowledge of a specific region to give you a quick reply, and microarray will take you into the details. What we have to understand here is the drawback of each test. As I told you about chromosome delay, now large number in FISH, the biggest advantage is that large number of nuclei can be studied, but limitation is that there will be only few chromosomal rearrangements you can see. And of course in microarray, though it is very, very important because it will help us in diagnosis, because diagnostic yield is about 10%. Unexplained developmental disabilities and congenital anomalies also are, you go closer to the diagnosis. But the drawback is it cannot detect balanced rearrangements. It provides reliable information of gains and losses, but are not of the orientation like ring isochromosome, isodiacentric chromosome. So if directly when you go to the next line of test, like for example, instead of karyotype to microarray, which I'll show you through some case studies. The importance of history taking is important in every part of tissue you study, whether it is products of conception, whether you're going to do blood for parents, whether it is prenatal, whether it is newborn baby and pediatric, infertility and oncology. Now coming to bad obstetric history, we deal both the things. We want to look at the products of conception and in the parents, whether they are the carriers. Chromosomes prior to ultrasound era, we used to look at the dysmorphic fetuses. and then come to the conclusion whether it was triploidy, because I have lived in this genomic era when the chromosomes were just like very closely starting banding, and there were not much of a prenatal diagnosis done, and also not at all the abortuses. Ultrasound examination was not there, so we used to look at these aborted fetuses and just come to some conclusion what it could be and offer counseling. After this ultrasound era, lot more chromosomal abnormality suspicions we know, and we are going to analyze all the fetuses today which can have chromosomal abnormalities. You can see these various karyotypes in products of conception. So various permutations, combinations, it can be one, that means like aneuploidy, it can be multiple. So this is how we will look at the chromosomes and then start the parental evaluation. In molar pregnancy, a complete heredity deformed mole occurs when an empty ovum is fertilized by a sperm. Approximately 80% of CHM are 46XX, other 20% are XY. In partial mole, the karyotype is 69XXY pattern. Egg receives two sets of paternal chromosomes, two sperms with no paternal genotype. Although all chromosomes are paternally derived, mitochondrial DNA is still retained. Maternal mutations, if there is a repeated molar pregnancy, then maternal mutations are known as mentioned in this region, in this slide. NLRP7 is 75%, and KHDCL3L is 5%. You know it. This leads to choriocarcinoma, you know better than me. But then if you are getting repeated molar pregnancies, then one has to go through this mutation analysis in the mother. First pregnancy, now this is a case now where the importance of taking family. Why I was showing that slide of the molar pregnancy? Because nowadays, very early, you send products of conception for chromosome analysis. And before that, even if beta HCG levels are then not seen. But if you get an abnormal chromosome, especially triploidy, it's important to screen that for even whether there could be a cause of molar pregnancy. So histopathological study or beta HCG monitoring is very important. And that is why that slide is shown. Now, importance of taking family history. Now, this is a case, very interesting case, when you look at products of conception. Now, here, this particular patient, you can look at the pedigree. This patient had pregnancy wastage or terminated because of diaphragmatic hernia and bilateral echogenic kidneys. And the karyotype showed inversion of X chromosome. They came to us for karyotyping, and after taking detailed history, no relevant history was provided. A husband and wife karyotype was done. Wife was also carrying this inversion X. And then husband called us one day because he said, "Madam, you were asking all the time about family history. My wife has got a brother who is 17 years of age. And he's slightly, I mean, we would call it intellectually deficient. IQ is definitely low, but they are not accepting it. So she has not told you the history." After convincing the lady without telling him that your husband gave us the history, we did karyotype of her mother and also of this boy. He was also carrying inversion X. So inversion X, because it's only on one chromosome which they are having and second one is Y. He was intellectually deficient, but the ladies were normal. In next pregnancy, she came to us. We did prenatal diagnosis and that was also inversion X. And they terminated the pregnancy. This we did much before any clinical ultrasound picture was seen because it was early in pregnancy. The next case, I would tell the importance of genetic counseling. In this, you will see this particular case, the lady presented with us karyotype. As you can see in this third pregnancy, there was a chromosomal abnormality. Now, after the first termination of pregnancy with multiple anomalies, her karyotype was done. Her was normal, and husband's karyotype showed there was a translocation between 8 and 13 chromosomes. Now, she was counseled somewhere that your karyotype is balanced. Nothing is going to happen to you. So don't worry about any pregnancies. She went ahead with another pregnancy without getting explanation on why this chromosomal this is a predisposing factor and you will need prenatal diagnosis. So she went ahead and this pregnancy, this was an abnormal child. So inappropriate genetic counseling is always very risky. Then last pregnancy, she came with us and then of course, fortunately this baby was normal. very important to identify the karyotypes. Now, this inversion X would have been totally missed if you would have directly jumped to microarray. Now, wrong sequence of tests. This is again another test. VVIP patient, also doctor. So 7 weeks missed abortion, next pregnancy it was IUFD, and directly clinical exome sequencing was advised. So no pathogenic, or likely pathogenic variant identified. They were told to go ahead with pregnancy. Going to the history, as we can saw in earlier generation also, there was history of multiple pregnancy losses. Then there was IVF failures. So that history was very contributory. And we said, we will have to do your karyotyping. And as you can see, husband's karyotype, again, there was a translocation. So no advanced test was required. So that is what I all the time insist, that we must start with the minimal test, which is, I would say, 3 or 5 times cheaper than the advanced test, where first, especially in products of conception, which should be done. Another thing now, going into prenatal diagnosis. In prenatal diagnosis, indications are, we all know, so basically chromosome is advanced maternal soft markers and positive maternal serum screen. Let's go to the case studies. Now in case study, what is important in this, that methods of sampling and tissue selection. Because if there is any maternal cell contamination, the reports can go wrong. So, and in cytogenetics, only precautions we take as when you do an amnio, to discard few initial drops of the amniotic fluid at amniocentesis, and collect it in 2 tubes. Do not forget to label. Even today, we get samples which come unlabeled. These 2 tubes are treated as 2 different patients, and then our own report in the laboratory should match. In chorion villus sampling, of course, maternal cell contamination rate is slightly higher, but you can have this well-dissected chorionic villi. And chorionic villi are our first choice of tissue when you are doing any molecular testing. Important now, you can see this is purple square. Right tissue at right time and the right test is what all the time I keep testing. It's an atma of genetic test. Because in chromosomal disorder, if you look at this syndrome called Pallister-Killian syndrome, now diaphragmatic hernia you will detect much later in pregnancy, in the sense not in first trimester mostly. But when you get that, tendency is to give quick report. If she's 18 weeks or so, you want to do cord blood sampling. And if cord blood sampling is done, you are going to totally miss the diagnosis, because this particular isochromosome 12p, which you see, it only grows in fibroblasts. So for thus such women, such kind of history, you should always have amniotic fluid culture. And therefore, I always insist, whenever you have a case, you remember that, one should remember that, you should always get in touch with the laboratory, at least over a telephone, and discuss the ultrasound features and find out the right test for your patient. Now here another case, now DMT was increased risk for trisomy 21. And I think Priya will remember this case. NIPT was showing 22q deletion. And we did, then we suggested amniotic fluid. She already had 1 pregnancy loss. After that, there was a normal child. And she wanted, and the previous 1 termination was because of trisomy 21 done elsewhere. Now she was not ready to undergo this amniotic fluid to confirm 22q deletion, because fetus did not have any abnormality. Congenital malformation at that gestation was noted. But we explained to her, at least giving this, if it is, if 22q NIPT report, because it will have its limitation, which again Dr. Priya can tell us better. And then this particular amniocentesis detected 22q deletion, it was positive, and ultrasound markers were not there. Now slide, we can see a next case study. So in this particular confirmation, this is what 22q, the same patient here. No, this is another patient, sorry. This is another patient, advanced maternal age. And in this particular, there was another marker, like she had 40 in the products of conception, 47X flap plus, there was a marker, 22q deletion was there. And we did with fish also. And then mother's chromosomal analysis was done. There was again 822 translocations. So next pregnancy for her maternal age, as well as for this chromosome, she would need both the tests. So only fish is not going to work, and only NIPT may not be advisable. Increased NT is the most common referral for chromosomal analysis, prenatal diagnosis. And if NT comes normal, we have to remember that increased NT is associated with high incidence of aneuploidy, as well as more than 150 genetic syndromes like Noonan, then achondrogenesis type 2, Smith-Lemelyopes. Now, NT below 3.5 millimeters, if it is there, of course. Then if it is above that, first trimester combined test, I don't think in such cases combined test will be good. But at least invasive prenatal test is advised, because chances of chromosomal abnormality is much higher. Traditional karyotyping was the first test of choice in this particular case. It was actually repeated NT, but first they terminated without doing any genetic test. Now, this particular case, it was the analysis was done, and we found that this there was a heterozygous duplication. Entire gene was there, and you can see there was a pathogenic variant was observed. What was that syndrome? Yeah, it was the Charcot-Marie syndrome. So you can see this reference also. So increased NT, one has to go beyond chromosomes. Down syndrome, microarray, all of us, Down syndrome, we do normally all karyotypes. You have to remember, if you see a child with clinical features of Down syndrome or all the markers of Down syndrome on your ultrasound, there is one syndrome which you call Down syndrome, one type which you can detect by microarray, is you will have all the features of Down syndrome, but karyotype is going to be normal. No translocation, no mosaic, no trisomy. That is because of partial trisomy of the important region, that is 21q11.2q22.3, which encompasses the Down syndrome critical region. Now, it's important that you have to explain, counsel the patient when we tell that karyotype report is 99%, especially for Down syndrome, and if there are other ultrasound markers, that this test to be reserved and take a written consent, even if it is rare, but you should not land into trouble. Now, resolving problem karyotypes, I think I can take it in the next lecture, but just to remember, go quickly, that common trisomy means there is no dilemma. Then if there is sex chromosome, it's very, very difficult because they can be either the individual, that means the fetus when born can be definitely either just having hypogonadism case in later life, or he can be having even intellectual deficiency associated. Uncommon trisomies, we require confirmation by other tissues. Translocations, of course, evaluation of parents necessary. And marker chromosome, you have to do further tests as well as parental karyotype. Another thing is now a lot of molecular tests are being done. Though today chromosomal test is the highest, if we are doing about, say, 200 to 300 prenatals per month at our center, nearly 80% are for chromosomal studies, but at least remaining 20% or less than 10%, in fact, for molecular, where thalassemia, when the patients come for this screening, also karyotype should be done. You can see case 3 and case 5. These came for thalassemia, but then we did karyotype as well. That is our protocol at the center. An entire karyotype, not just FISH. So the first case, number 3, had fetus had translocation X2. And the second case was there was 47, there was extra chromosome 21. So you require further counseling and parental evaluation as well. Next is like pediatric and adult syndromic, non-syndromic. Ambiguous genitalia, if somebody asks me in the clinic, all my staff is trained that when you see a sample where no history is given and it is a one-day-old child, think of it first ambiguous genitalia or it could be Down. Do not wait for anything. Please start processing immediately and put it on priority. Now, ambiguous genitalia is 1 in 4,500. And it is very devastating to the parent because first thing, what everybody asks, kya hua? What is the sex of the child? Because they want to know what to declare. Birth registrations are deferred. So this is taken as a topmost priority. Immediately, we do FISH studies. If the chromosomes come normal, then our chromosomes are showing, or the FISH is showing that sex is matching with the phenotype, then there is not much issue. But if at all there is mismatch, then you have to immediately go into the history about maternal virilization or if there are any autosomal recessive or dominant syndromes associated with it. Then of course, Down syndrome, importance of parental karyotype. Again, this we have seen very often. We had one IVF case where first pregnancy loss was with the trisomy 21. Parental karyotype was not done. second pregnancy, she came to us. Again, it was a Down syndrome. And then she was 21-21 translocation. So if a parent is having 21-21 translocation, there is 100% chance that there is a recurrence risk. Other translocations like 14-21, if father is a carrier, it is 8%. Mother recurrence risk is 14%. So evaluation of Down syndrome parents is extremely important for counseling. Other genomic imprinting, Prader-Willi, Angelman are also known. Most important thing is both these syndromes are because of the chromosome 15 on the deletion on chromosome 15 Q12 region. And when it comes, the Prader-Willi syndrome is paternally derived and Angelman is maternally derived. Though recurrence risk is 1%, this Angelman syndrome was our case. Where the recurrence risk even being 1%, parent opted for prenatal diagnosis and the sibling was normal. Another microdeletion, DiGeorge, we all know, Williams. We can move further. Now, infertility and chromosomes is again very important thing to consider. XYY parents usually have normal fetuses, nothing much to worry about because they are also slightly aggressive, but it's not a big problem. But if at all you get in the prenatal tissue, then you have to tell them definitely, as we cannot declare the sex, it becomes very difficult to counsel. You have to go very cleverly with the counseling, depending on what kind of family situation is this. This particular man, father was 47XYY, fetus was normal. He had not come, but when I took the history, he was so aggressive, it seems, that he had literally beaten up his principal and he was thrown out of the school. So this is how it is. This picture you can see here, you can have gynecomastia in XXY, or mentally challenged child. So you have to explain them. Another important thing of over last 5 years, we are seeing approximately 5 years, lot of patients we are getting reports with isodiacentric Y. Now, when you get this isodiacentric Y, it's very critical because if the child is born, suppose pregnancy is continued or a born child is there, the phenotype is going to be, especially in fetal amniotic fluid, if you get this, the child can have, if they, for example, terminate the pregnancy because you will tell them that the features are, the report is showing that there is a possibility of sex chromosomal abnormality. You cannot again declare the sex. But child after termination, they can, if they terminate, can be completely normal looking phenotype. You can have ambiguous genitalia or it can be looking normal, perfectly normal. And they are going to jump at you saying that when we terminated, you said baby can have ambiguous genitalia, but our fetus is normal. And we have to take into confidence the referral doctor and tell him these details to explain. Autosomal abnormalities are also, these are usually familial where you can get chromosomal translocations. So they were two brothers, severe oligospermia and autosomal translocation. Another, first I will tell you about an interesting case down here. In secondary infertility, this couple had first daughter who died. He had accidental death. Husband was 54 years of age, wife 48. They were going to take egg donation and they sought us through some reference. And I told them, come what may, even if you have lost your previous child, she who was normal, it was infertility, they never planned a child. And you want to, actually, I want to do your karyotype. And believe me that this particular man had XY translocation. So even, 19Y translocation, even they would have taken a donor and not done husband's karyotype, donor egg, their pregnancies would have been abnormal. So they were counseled according. Next, now we can talk about is one case. This first time we saw that in severe oligospermia, there was inversion of X chromosome and the region was P32Q42. There's one band above that, so little on band level position also. But this is the first case which I've seen in my practice. And there is a reference, somebody who is interested, we can just forward them. So we have to look at the autosomes as well. Another important is testicular feminization. Sex chromosomal abnormalities in the female, these are two slides. On right hand side, again, we had triple X case. Case two was having extra chromosome X. And definitely she had intellectual deficiency. This female, the first one, she was economist, 30 years old female, 6'2" tall, IQ was normal definitely, and recurrent pregnancy losses. So again, it becomes very difficult when you get such cases where chromosomal abnormality, sex chromosomal abnormality, again, this is of great importance in prenatal genetic counseling. Testicular feminization, we can go back. Testicular feminization, again, you see commonly. And you all know what are the consequences of testicular feminization. But important thing here, it can be familial because it is X-linked recessive. Sometimes an autosomal gene also can be there. So if you get testicular feminizing child, other family member, if there is any history of primary amenorrhea, one should counsel them accordingly. Because this particular case, first girl when came to us, she wanted to marry and then she knew that she was having some problem. Of course, at early gestation, you can get inguinal hernia, but later on they come to you because primary amenorrhea. And she came for primary amenorrhea and she was quite aware of her condition, but she did not get her karyotype done. She said, you explain to me, but I said, okay, let's go to the next thing. Give you the counseling and talk to your obstetrician because you are married and what kind of management will be required. Another most important, which again every obstetrician should know, that primary and secondary amenorrhea, I'm looking at X chromosome, say 45 X chromosome. In secondary and primary secondary amenorrhea cases, if women like menstruate spontaneously, there is secondary amenorrhea, they are infertile. 45X is very much straightforward. So all the chromosomal abnormalities which are mentioned, wherever there is in this chart mentioned, you can take a photograph of this. If they menstruate spontaneously, secondary amenorrhea, 50% are infertile. And without doing their karyotyping, if the fertility management is done, chances that they will produce abnormal children is very high. Again, we'll come to the premature. So you must remember that in secondary amenorrhea cases, one has to look into the karyotype and find out whether they are having karyotypic abnormality of X chromosome. Now, in sex chromosomal abnormalities, we have seen these other types, ring, any type of chromosome you can get, along with its normal XO, triple X, or all these chromosomal abnormalities mentioned. Another important thing is premature ovarian failure. Now, we'll go directly to premature ovarian failure, where there is a possibility of fragile X. Also, in the left-hand side, there can be autosomal translocation. So previous child, chromosome karyotype was done, and this X2 translocation is of that mother where you saw that fetus had X2 who came for thalassemia. Now, this particular female is likely to get premature ovarian failure, and you have to counsel her not only for prenatal diagnosis, but to plan her pregnancies early. Because it was autosomal. Now, in fragile X, we all know that one of the important cause of, premature ovarian failure. So it can be, patient can come for infertility, irregular periods. Then fragile X carrier mutation test needs to be done. Now, the repeats, if there are 550 to 200 CGG repeats, they could be premature mutation carriers. There is another thing which you look into this to check is that AGG interruptions. These are the ones which identification of these interruptions in carrier also tell you that possibility of transmitting into the next generation will be of fewer interruptions, and the risk of fragile X in the baby will be small. The next one is now a specific planning for pregnancy with previously affected child. This was a Down syndrome, again, having a marker chromosome. Like I mentioned earlier, marker chromosome needs to be evaluated. You can't just go for because she's maternal age and previous Downs to go directly into the prenatal diagnosis without identifying. Now you can find out the chance of her chromosomal abnormality by carrier. There was one more slide which we have missed, I think. What the law looks into. I think I would like to show that in prenatal diagnosis. I can just tell you meanwhile the story. In chromosomal abnormality, it was for absent nasal, hypoplastic nasal bone. And in that we detected that there was an additional, this is very important slide which you should know, what the law demanded. So there was hypoplastic nasal bone. At 19 weeks she came, fish was normal. We did karyotype, and karyotype showed there was extra 9P. and it was a big segment. Now we could not assign this chromosome. We just knew that this was absolutely an extra chromosome, and we gave our report as this is of unknown origin, but is definitely pathogenic. Because she had crossed 24, almost 22 weeks, court did not accept. Court said for termination, what kind of pathogenicity? If we would not have had microarray, we would have just said that, yes, it is pathogenic. But I think lawyer was quite clever, knew something about this. So he asked us to give us further report. And microarray showed that this deletion, they identified there was gain on chromosome 9. And this would indicate that trisomy for the region was characterized by developmental disorder, behavior problems, and some kind of congenital anomalies. So it's very important that even if you do at later gestation, simultaneously to get from a microarray done. Now we can go to the, I think almost to the last part of the presentation is about hematological malignancies. Now go to hematological malignancies. Now hematological disorders, of course you don't come much into, may not be requiring, or some patient may come to you. I just want to tell you, these are all acquired chromosomal abnormalities. What we looked at so far were all constitutional. So these chromosomes can appear, they can disappear. So these are the various types of hematological, we have taken just few examples. Now AML, CML, all these kind of, now we'll just go on to the, yeah, what is the information? From cytogenetic analysis in hematological malignancies at diagnosis, I told you that these are constitutional. So evidence of clonality and cell lineage, confirmation of the diagnosis, pre-treatment prognosis information, relationship of apparently different diseases, constitutional or acquired disease, therapy-related neoplasm, and detection of minimal residual disease. At follow-up, evidence of disease regression, evidence of disease recrudescence and evolution, evidence of engraftment following bone marrow transplant, and peripheral blood stem transplantation. Now, distinction between relapse and secondary therapy and related to neoplasm or leukemia resulting from neoplastic transformation of a donor stem cell. I want to tell you that when I started my genetics practice first in the country, one of the first center, private center, when I went to various hospitals, I was told first genetics is not required for our country. So I said, let me go in private. I went to the hematologist saying that, because my training was, the full training was in US when genetic training was not much available. So hematological malignancies, I went to cancer hospital. They said, we don't require, looking at clinical indication, we can just tell what kind of therapy we will be giving. So now you can see this advances in, and I feel really proud that I have come from cadaveric dissection to genomic dissection like all of us have come. Now in conclusion, chromosomal anomalies form a major chunk of genetic disorders, can detect balanced translocations, inversions, insertions, helping in recurrence risk estimation and early prenatal diagnosis. It is important to store DNA of index case, because if chromosomes come normal, then it is important to go for further testing if required. Genetic techniques are specific and greatly helpful in single gene disorders. Pre and post-based genetic counseling is an inseparable part of genetic and genomic diagnosis. Informed written consent is recommended for all cases. Remember, you have to remember that most genetic disorders are not treatable, but almost all are preventable. At the end, I would like to tell you the importance of chromosomal studies you have seen, and we have to like treat chromosome as a very important test in your test menu. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lema, for that very engaging talk. So I invite the audience for any questions or comments in the Q&A section.
Yeah, actually, in fact, we can have these questions and then pass on these questions. I request all audience, any questions, whatever it may be, any patient's report, you do not know what to be done next, you can put on, and then we will try to get back to you.
Sure, Dr. Mandakini. So I think probably we'll move on to our next speaker. So our next speaker, as mentioned before, is Dr. Shagun Agarwal. And she's going to be talking to us about single gene disorders and Mendelian disorders. Over to you, Dr. Shagun.
Yeah, thank you, Joseph. Are my slides visible?
Yes, madam, it's visible.
Okay. Yeah, so good afternoon, everybody. And thank you to Foxy and Medjinum for making me part of this program. So what I'm going to talk to you today about is a different category of genetic disorders. So like Dr. Hema has covered the chromosomal disorders. So I'm going to cover the single gene disorders. These are also called as monogenic disorders or Mendelian disorders. And awareness about this is relatively less as compared to the chromosomal disorders, but these are equally relevant in the OBG practice. And in fact, all of you must have seen patients affected with one or more of these conditions, but because you're not aware of this, you may not have recognized it. But we would try to see how it's very important to recognize these conditions and why do we need to do further testing? What is the implication for the patient? So first, let's just go through some basic concepts of genetics. So we have seen a lot of, in the previous talk, we have already learned a lot about the chromosomes and their conditions associated with chromosome abnormalities. So if we look at the chromosomes actually, so as we have learned that there are 23 pair of chromosomes in the human body, and these are basically located in the nucleus of the cell. Now these chromosomes are actually nothing, but these are basically tightly packed DNA. So if we open up the chromosomes, we'll actually see that there are kind of all these strands which are tightly packed inside a chromosome, and you start unfurling these strands. So you see that these are actually first initially they will come like this bead of string appearance, and then as you further unfurl, eventually what it is just a DNA. So it's basically the DNA which has been tightly packed, and when it becomes packed like this and coiled upon itself, it starts becoming visible under the microscope, and then that is what we see in the form of a chromosome. So what is DNA now? So DNA is the basic unit of heredity. We know that in the sense that that's a basic molecule which is carrying all the genetic information. So the human DNA is made up of 3 billion base pairs. So what we mean by base pairs are basically there are these four bases, adenine, guanine, thymine, and cytosine. So these are the four bases, and these four bases are basically joined one after another to form this chain. And they are also, there are two chains in the DNA, so they kind of pair with each other. So that's why we call it as base pairing. So the DNA is basically a string of these bases, adenine, guanine, cytosine, and thymine. So these are all arranged one after another. And genes are nothing, but these are the stretches of DNA. So a DNA is really long, but there are certain parts of the DNA which are actually going to go ahead and make a protein. So this functional part of a DNA is what is called as a gene. And there are approximately 15 to 20,000 genes in the human body. So then when we try to correlate this with the kind of genetic diseases which can happen, so one category which we have already looked at are the chromosomal disorders. So whenever there is a problem in the number of a chromosome or the structure of a chromosome, that is some part is missing, some part is extra, then what we get is a chromosomal disorders. And we have already seen so many examples of this, how they all present in the practice. So these are relatively easy to diagnose using a simple karyotype and some other cytogenetic techniques. Then besides this, another group of disorders, which are again a kind of chromosomal disorders only, but they cannot be really seen under a karyotype. So these are basically called as microdeletion or microduplication syndromes. And they happen because a very tiny segment of the chromosome has got deleted or it has got duplicated. And that is causing some extra genetic material, either some material to come in or to get lost. So these kind of small changes will not be visible on a karyotype. We have to use some special techniques like FISH or microarray, and then only we can diagnose this group of conditions. So this is another group, but what we are going to focus today are on the single gene disorders. So what happens in the single gene disorder is basically the change or the defect happens at the level of the DNA. So in the DNA molecule per se, even change of a single base, So if an adenine is replaced by a guanine, that single change of the base can lead to a disease. So such a change in the base at the level of the DNA, this is called as a mutation. And these mutations also can be of different types. So basically the main thing to remember is that this is the change happening right in the DNA molecule, and it's a very tiny change. And this cannot be seen either by karyotype or by other cytogenetic techniques like microarray and FISH and all. For this, we need to actually go and sequence the DNA molecule. Then only we will be able to detect these kind of conditions. So this is the group we are going to focus on today. So again, this is not uncommon. So you may be thinking that we've not heard of this, and these some seem to be some really rare vague conditions, but that's not true. So if we look at the prevalence of birth prevalence of chromosomal disorders as a group, it is around 1 in 200. Okay, 1 in 200 newborn is born with a chromosomal abnormality, whereas for a single gene disorder, this is double. So 1 in 100 newborn is born with one or the other single gene disorder. So there are around 6,000 to around 7,000 single gene disorders, and one or other of these condition occurs in 1% of newborn. So these are not rare actually. These are also quite common conditions. It's just that because of lack of awareness, often we are not able to recognize this or do further testing for this. So again, in these single gene disorders, we can have the various what we call as patterns of inheritance. So, or in the way, this basically means the various different ways in which these disorders run in the families. So here we have the autosomal dominant and autosomal recessive genetic disorders. So basically here the gene where the mutation is there is located on the autosome. So autosome is the chromosome from any chromosome from 1 to 22. So that's, those are all autosomes. They are same in males and females. So if there is a mutation in a gene which is in one of those chromosomes, then it is an autosomal single gene disorder, and it can be inherited in a dominant fashion or in a recessive fashion. So dominant is something which when the disease happens, on even if one of the copy of the gene is having the mutation. So we need to remember, just like there are pairs of each chromosome, there are pairs of each genes. So each of the gene would be having two copies. One is on each of the chromosomes. So that's why. So you have always two copies of every gene. And in dominant condition, only if one copy is also getting a mutation, then also the disease will manifest. Whereas in a recessive condition, when both the copies of the gene get deleted or mutated, then also then only the disease manifests. With a single copy getting a mutation, there is no effect or no clinical phenotype. So these are the dominant and recessive disorders, and I'll just explain it a little bit further again. And then we have the X-linked conditions. So these are because of mutations in genes which are present on the X chromosome. So here there becomes a difference between the genders, because the females have two X chromosomes and the male has only one X chromosome. So in a male condition, whereby only a single mutation is good enough, will not cause a disease in the female, will cause a disease in the male, because he doesn't have the second copy of the gene at all, because there is no second X chromosome. So this kind of conditions are called as X-linked recessive conditions. Means in the female, the manifestation will not occur if only one of the X is having the mutation. But in the male, the manifestation or the disease will happen even if the mutation is in the one X chromosome, because that's the only X chromosome in the male. And then we have the X-linked dominant, which manifests even in the female. And then rarely there are some Y-linked, not really diseases, but Y-linked traits, which may be inherited from basically through the Y chromosome. So they go from father to son. So those are very extremely rare situations. So what we have mainly, what we see in practice are these four types of inheritance patterns. So we have the autosomal dominant disorder. So how you can recognize it in a family is immediately by seeing that a disease, same disease is running across different generations in that family. So like this grandparent is affected, his two sons are affected, and then even the next generation children are affected. So here, just because many of you may not be familiar with what these diagrams mean. So basically these are what we call as a pedigree. So a pedigree is nothing but diagrammatic representation of the family tree. So here we use certain standard, very simple symbols to denote people in the family. So like a square always represents a male, a circle represents a female, a horizontal line connecting a male and female represent a relationship line, and a vertical line drawn from this relationship line indicates an offspring line. And then whenever we shade somebody, it means that that person is affected with a particular genetic disease. And like that, we have certain other symbols. Like here, we see these two lines between these two individuals. So this is basically indicating consanguinity. So like that, there are certain symbols to denote basically the family in a simple diagrammatic way. So that just by looking at this, we get so much information about the whole family. So then when we are saying dominant condition, we are basically seeing that the grandparent, the parent here, and then the next generation, suppose this girl here, so all three are affected. So whenever you have a family whereby you can see multiple members across different generation getting affected with the same condition, that means it's an autosomal dominant disorder. And then you have the autosomal recessive disorder. These usually manifest in the form of siblings being affected, but parents being healthy. So here, both the parents are actually carriers of the disease. So they will not have any manifestation because this is a recessive disease. So parents are having mutation on only one copy of their gene. The second copy is normal copy. So these parents, they are not affected because this is a recessive condition. But when two such individuals who are carriers or who are heterozygous also is the term we use, so who are carrying mutation in one of the copy of their gene, when two such people get married to each other, then their children may get both the defective copies of the genes from their parents, and then they will manifest the disease. So such diseases occur in siblings, and here the parents are healthy and there is nobody else usually in the family who is similarly affected in the previous generations, but there would be multiple asymptomatic carriers in that particular family, and the risk of such kind of this kind of genetic diseases increases if there is consanguinity, because when two people are consanguineous, they are actually sharing their gene pool, and when they share their gene pool, they may also be sharing certain mutations. So because of which, whenever there is consanguinity, the risk of autosomal recessive disorder increases. So when you see a situation like this in the clinic, two siblings, two or more siblings having the same disease, but nobody else in the family is affected, think that this may be an autosomal recessive condition. And then we have the X-linked recessive condition where the females remain unaffected, only the males get affected. But these males are usually connected through some females in the family. So these females are carriers. So these dots in the center indicate that these people are all carriers of that disease. So females don't get affected because they have two copies of the X chromosome. So this is X-linked recessive disorder. And then we have, this is a rarer inheritance pattern, X-linked dominant condition, whereby both males and females are affected, but males are affected more severely by the same condition. So in fact, sometimes the males may be so severely affected that they may die in the perinatal period. So you may have something like this. So whatever you're seeing, these small blue dots, these are actually representing pregnancy losses. So these are all male pregnancy losses which have happened, and the females have survived, but the females are affected with that disease. So this is a kind of X-linked dominant condition. And why it's really important to know these different inheritance patterns is because often by recognizing the inheritance pattern, we can actually come to know what could be the possible diagnosis in a particular family. And we can also find out that who all in the family are likely to be carriers of that disease, who all are the individuals whose children may get affected. So by knowing this information, we can prevent the genetic disease from happening in other pregnancies in that particular family. And then, of course, there are various other uses also. But for all practical purposes, this is one of the main use. If we know the inheritance pattern, we can actually help in the family in so many different ways. So now, how do these conditions present in the OBG clinic? So that's what is practically relevant for all of you. So in various situations, during the reproductive span of a lady, you could have these single gene disorders presenting in different fashions. So you could have patients coming up in the premarital period with problems of amenorrhea, genital ambiguity, or sometimes somebody has come because they are planning to get married to a family member in a consanguineous relationship. Or there may be somebody who's come because there is a family history of a genetic disorder, and now they're concerned whether when they get married, whether their children will get affected or not. So in the premarital period, these could be the situations whereby it becomes relevant to think about single gene disorders. Then there could be patients who could be coming in the preconceptional period, so who have got married and planning for a child. So they could again come sometimes with something like secondary amenorrhea or infertility issues, or there could be again consanguinity concerns or family history of a genetic disorders, recurrent pregnancy losses or bad obstetric history, or having a previous child with a genetic disorder. So here in all these situations, they can come to you with the potential single gene condition in the preconceptional period. And finally, in the prenatal period, again, due to consanguinity or family history of genetic disorder, previous pregnancy losses, patients can come for counseling, or they could be having a previous child with a genetic disorder or an abnormal ultrasound, and they want to now do prenatal testing for that. So these are the various situations where you could actually be thinking about genetic conditions, more specifically single gene disorders. And then now we'll see through some cases what kind of conditions could manifest in this way and how we could approach such situations. So first, let's think about the preconceptional or the premarital period. So during this period, some of the common concerns which could be genetic in origin, one of them is problems related to genital ambiguity. So here again, Dr. Hema had told in a talk about the chromosomal abnormalities which could present as genital ambiguity, but we also need to be aware of that there are various single gene disorders which could also present in a similar fashion. So here actually, this was this lady who was 21-year-old who had come to us. So she had one male and one female sibling, and her parents were married consanguinously. So you can see the double line here. And this lady basically had clitoromegaly and excessive pubic hair right since birth. And since 10 years of age, she had developed excessive body hair and also signs of precocious puberty. There was no history of a salt losing crisis, and she was operated for clitoromegaly at 12 years of age. On examination, there was no dysmorphism. Her IQ was normal, anthropometry also being normal, and her karyotype was also normal. But when we did a hormonal profile, she had a raised 17 OHP and also raised androgens also, and the ultrasound abdomen showed presence of PCOS. So actually putting all these things together, the clinical diagnosis for her was a non-salt losing type of classical congenital adrenal hyperplasia. So as you're all aware, this condition is the commonest cause of genital ambiguity in a 46XX individual. And mostly, most of these babies do get recognized right at birth because they have overt ambiguity. And many of them would even have salt losing crisis. So they do come to attention. Preterms can present to you later in a gynecology clinic with concerns of hirsutism or a PCOS kind of presentation. So here, because this was the specific diagnosis which we had in mind, and this disease is caused by mutations in only one gene. So this is a gene which whereby if there is a mutation, then this disease results. So we went ahead for a straightforward genetic testing, and this name of basically this test is Sanger sequencing. So this is nothing but sequencing this particular gene or reading the base sequence of this gene, what in the form of like what you can see here, guanine, thymidine. So this is a sequence in which the bases are arranged in this gene. And we already have information about what is the normal sequence of the gene. So when we do read the sequence in our patient using this technique called as Sanger sequencing, then we get the sequence of the bases in our patient, and we can compare it with the normal and see if there is a change or if there is a mutation. So in this patient, there was a mutation. So there was a homozygous. So homozygous means that both copies of the gene are having the mutation. So homozygous mutation in this particular gene, and this was a missense mutation, and this was what was causing the clinical picture. So with this, we were able to establish the diagnosis for this particular patient and start her on subsequent therapy. So here, basically, what is Sanger sequencing? So I've already just told you in brief. So we basically know that we want to read the sequence of a particular gene. So we have a clinical diagnosis. We know that what is the gene which causes that particular disease, which we are suspecting clinically. So now we want to check the sequence of bases in that gene. So we are going to read that. So to read that, we use this technique called as Sanger sequencing. And it gives the result in form of these kind of peaks, which are known as chromatograms. And these are nothing but basically, if we read on the top, we can see the various bases one after another. And we then compare it with the normal, which we are already having, and we can see whether there is a change or not. So just to summarize this ambiguity concern, so chromosomal abnormality is one group of genetic disorder which can present as genital ambiguity, but single gene disorder is the other large group, and in which congenital adrenal hyperplasia is one of the important condition, and the other one, which again many of you would have seen patients, is the androgen insensitivity syndrome, also known as testicular feminization syndrome, whereby a patient has a 46XY karyotype, but then because of the problem in the androgen receptor, the androgen is not able to act on the external genitalia. So there is a presence of ambiguity or even sometimes complete feminization. So external genitalia are completely female type. And there are various other single gene disorders which present with sex reversal, that is with 46XY karyotype but 40 female phenotype, or sometimes ambiguous phenotype. So these are all actually single gene disorders, and it is important to diagnose them because, for example, in CAH, so like in this particular case, giving corticosteroid therapy actually can restore the fertility of the patient. Then in specific situations, making your diagnosis can help in taking decision for hormone replacement therapy, for gonadectomy, deciding the sex of rearing or genitoplasty surgery. So all these decisions can be taken. And there is also an implications for counseling for recurrence stress. So for example, if you have a patient with androgen insensitivity syndrome, so she's a phenotypic female. So she may be having a sister who is actually genotypic also female. So she may be having a sister, 46XX karyotype. And this sister may also be carrying the same mutation as her. So this sister's male child tomorrow can again have androgen insensitivity. So you can actually kind of identify other people in the family who may be at risk. You can offer prenatal testing to those people. So this goes a long way in not only patients' management, but also kind of offering certain preventive strategies for other family members. So now let's go to the second scenario. So here we have got a girl who's come to us with secondary amenorrhea, and she's having basically hypergonadotrophic hypogonadism. And in this particular situation, then the karyotype is normal. But what's interesting is that she has two brothers, and both of them are affected with intellectual disability. So if we look at the brothers, actually, so we can say that they are also having some dysmorphism. So this is an elder brother. So in the elder brother, we can see a really pointed and very prominent jaw, slightly prominent ears, which are there. Even this younger brother has prominent ears and somewhat prominent jaw. So this is the pedigree. So again, two male affected. And this is the girl who's come to us. So whenever we see a situation like this, actually, we think of a condition called as Fragile X syndrome. So Fragile X syndrome, you may be familiar with, is one of the causes of intellectual disability, primarily in males. But then in Fragile X syndrome, there could be other females in the family who are carrying what is called as a premutation. So Fragile X is actually a specific type of genetic disorder in which we have a special type of mutation called as trinucleotide expansion. So these trinucleotide expansions are basically certain repeats in our body. And these repeats are usually in particular one gene, there could be a certain number of repeats. Repeats as in this case, like we have those repeats in the form of CTG repeats in case of Fragile X. So these, you would have these repeats like CTG, CTG, CTG one after another. So normally the number is less than 50. If it crosses more than that, then we have something called as a premutation. And beyond a particular limit, that is if they cross 200 in number, then we get a full mutation. So when a patient, a male patient is affected with Fragile X syndrome, usually they will have more than 200 repeats. So that's what the brother had. So this is a special type of genetic test known as TPPCR. And this is the test which is done for Fragile X. This cannot be diagnosed using Sanger sequencing. So here the brother had this condition, whereas the sister had what is called as premutation. So she has two X chromosomes. So one X chromosome had normal number of repeats, that is 50, but the other X chromosome had 80 repeats, which falls into premutation range. So premutation means that it is not yet a full mutation, it is slightly less than that. Full mutation is more than 200 repeats. So this girl was found to have premutation in the FMR1 gene or Fragile X gene. And in fact, if and her brothers were affected with this condition. So if you have any patient with premature ovarian failure, so if there is a positive family history of premature ovarian failure, that is any other female in the family also has premature ovarian failure, then there is a 15% chance that your patient may be having FMR1 premutation. And even with sporadic individuals with POF, 2 to 5% of such individuals have an FMR1 premutation. But then you'll say, why do we need to check for this? This is not going to help in treatment. So, but no, this is like really relevant. So one thing is that many of these patients who are having Fragile X premutation, they may present with secondary amenorrhea, but often they do have follicles in their ovaries. And when you go take them up for ART, they may actually conceive and their male children would then go on to develop Fragile X syndrome and have intellectual disability. So this can be actually prevented. Once you have identified this lady with a premutation, you can actually offer her pre-implantation genetic testing or prenatal testing and prevent birth of a child with intellectual disability. And also it can help in screening of other female family members. Like this lady had a younger sister. So now we can screen that sister. That sister may not yet be symptomatic. She may still be having her cycles, but she may also be this premutation carrier. So in fact, screening her can also help in oocyte retrieval and preservation of oocytes for subsequent reproduction. So, and also of course, preventing the birth of an affected child. So again, testing for this is important and this is not that uncommon. So then let's go on to the next period in the reproductive life. So this is the preconception or early prenatal period. So in this, again, one of the common indications for which we see patients in our clinic are where there is a patient and she comes to us, she's pregnant and she has history of one or more than one family member with a suspected genetic disease, but there is no diagnosis. So this is a pretty common scenario, in fact. So here in such a situation, it's very important first to make a diagnosis of the affected individual in the family. Without making a diagnosis of the affected individual, it is not possible to do any kind of counseling for this couple and not possible to do any prenatal testing for this couple. So in this family, you can see this is a huge pedigree actually. So this was the lady who had come to us and she was 9 weeks, 2 days pregnant. She was also married consanguinely. consanguinity, but on her mother's side, she had multiple individuals, male individuals, all of them, who had problems with walking since early childhood, followed by loss of ambulation, and then subsequently death in late teens. So, if you remember the initial inheritance pattern I had shown, so we have here male affected members, they are connected through healthy females in the family. So this basically means that this is X-linked recessive inheritance. And the kind of symptoms these people have is very characteristic of a genetic condition called as Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So here, by looking at a pedigree, we can find out what is the inheritance pattern. And by looking at the clinical presentation of the individuals, we can have some presumptive diagnosis that, okay, this could be Duchenne muscular dystrophy. So now this much we have kind of come to ascertain through this. So now, but the problem is that all of them are deceased. So as I said, it's very important to make a diagnosis in the affected individual, because without doing that, we can't move a step ahead. But here, all these affected individuals are deceased, but we can see that there is at least one female relative, this lady, who's a grandmother of a patient. She has an affected mother, and also she has a affected grandchild here, this person. So this means that she is actually what we call as an obligate carrier. So this dot indicates a carrier. So this means that she is definitely carrying the mutation in a particular gene, in the DNA gene, because her brother is also affected and her daughter is also probably carrying. Her daughter is also probably carrier, because of which is also a carrier, because of which her daughter's children are also affected. So this lady is an obligate carrier, but we don't know what is this lady's, that is our patient's mother's status and the patient's carrier status. So what can we do now? We don't have the affected individuals for testing, but we can test this lady. We should be able to find the mutation in her also. So that is what was done. So an important thing to remember in DMD is that here the type of mutation is actually not at the level of a single base. It is a little larger mutation. It's mainly in the form of a deletion of whole exons, or basically deletion duplications of part of the DMD gene. So here the technique which we use for diagnosis is not Sanger sequencing. Here what we use is called as MLPA. So that is what we did. We did MLPA of the DMD gene, and then we found that the patient's grandmother was having a deletion from exon 46 to exon 55 in this gene. So which has further like kind of confirmed that the DMD was the disease in this family. The grandmother is a carrier. And then we tested the patient's mother and also the patient. So the patient's mother was a carrier, but the patient was not a carrier. So now when she is not a carrier, there is no risk to her child of developing DMD, and there is no implications in terms of offering prenatal testing for DMD in this family. So by looking at this case, we can see how it's very important. So there are different points here. So one thing is that it is important to make a complete pedigree, to take a complete family history. Then it's important to at least be able to see what could be the possible pattern of inheritance. Then by looking at the clinical picture, we can come to some kind of presumptive diagnosis also. Then we can try to identify whom in the families need to be tested. So ideally, it has to be the affected person. But sometimes rare situations when an affected person is not there, then we can test the obligate carrier. So an obligate carrier is a person who we know for sure is a carrier. How? Because of her position in the family and how the affected people are related to her. Like here we assume that this lady is an obligate carrier. So by doing this slowly, we can then target the concerned person for genetic testing. And then once we know the mutation, then only the subsequent steps with respect to recurrence risk counseling and with respect to offering prenatal testing comes. So again, just to reiterate, pattern of inheritance can be inferred many of the times, and we can identify the at-risk individuals who may be carriers or who may be pre-symptomatic and get affected later. But what is important is that we should have a molecular diagnosis because without a molecular diagnosis, we cannot do prenatal testing. And ideally, this should be done on the affected person. And the choice of test depends depending on the disease. So if suppose here it was thalassemia, beta thalassemia. So beta thalassemia is caused by mutations in the at the level of the single bases. So there we would have used Sanger sequencing. But here it was DMD. In DMD, we use MLPS. So that test of choice also differs from disease to disease. So then let's go on to another important period, which is the prenatal period. And here one of the commonest causes of a genetic referral are ultrasound abnormalities. So again, I'll begin with a case. So here we had a consanguineous couple, and this couple had a healthy baby, previous girl child. And then they had a preterm neonatal death, and this baby had high drops. And now they had presented again at 20 weeks pregnancy with high drops. So the scan was showing ascites, subcutaneous edema, pleural effusion, and also placentomegaly. So here we know that high drops actually is etiologically heterogeneous. So in fact, chromosomal disorders contribute significantly to high drops. They are one of the largest category of genetic disorders presenting with high drops. And the most common two most common chromosomal abnormalities are Down syndrome and Turner syndrome. So these are the two most common ones presenting as high drops fetalis. But besides this, there are so many other causes of high drops. So we could have cardiac defects, lymphatic dysplasias, and more than 100 other conditions. So here in this particular family, that fetus karyotype was normal, but we had parents who were consanguineous. We had a previous affected sibling. So which automatically raises red flag that this could probably be an autosomal recessive condition. So, but then again, there are so many autosomal recessive conditions which can present as high drops. So what do we do next? So here, this particular family, they had opted for an autopsy. So on autopsy, we found that the baby had hepatomegaly and even some splenomegaly was there. So we suspected that there is probably this is a storage disorder. And before going for autopsy, we had done an amniocentesis for this case. So what we did was that we did an enzyme assay on those amniotic cells, and this enzyme assay revealed that the baby was actually affected with a lysosomal storage disorder known as mucopolysaccharidosis type 7 or Sly disease. So this was the final diagnosis for this particular family, and this is an autosomal recessive condition. So now the recurrence risk for this particular couple for subsequent pregnancies is 25%, and now we will be able to offer prenatal testing as early as 11 to 12 weeks of pregnancy subsequently by doing a CBS. So we by making a diagnosis of this child, we can now help this couple in their subsequent pregnancies also. So then high drops is one of the presentation where we should be thinking of single gene disorders once we have ruled out chromosomal abnormality. Besides that, whenever you have prenatal sonographic abnormalities, various other abnormalities also raise concern of genetic conditions. So we can broadly divide sonographic abnormalities into soft markers. Soft markers, as you all know, in majority of cases are just normal variants, but then they are usually associated with an increased risk of chromosomal disorders. Then we have the structural abnormalities. This could be single or multiple. And these actually increase the risk of chromosomal abnormalities, but in addition also, they could be part of single gene disorders. And then various miscellaneous abnormality of the fetus like carotid placenta could also have underlying genetic basis. So if we try to look at newborn data, we find that 2 to 3% of newborns would actually be having a congenital malformation. And this could again be isolated or multisystemic or involving multiple organs. And in such situation where you have a congenital malformation, genetic etiologies contribute to around 15 to 35% of these cases, whereby both chromosomal and single gene etiologies contribute equally. And even some cases can have microdeletion, microduplication syndromes. So again, to reiterate that even in the setting of a malformation detected antenatally or at birth, single gene disorders are equally important, as compared to chromosomal disorders. So to take an example of a congenital heart disease, so a congenital heart disease could be part of Down syndrome, which is a chromosomal disorder. It could be part of a microdeletion syndrome like Digert syndrome, or it could be part of a Noonan syndrome, which is a single gene disorder. And all these conditions can be associated with intellectual disability and various other systemic comorbidities. So if you see a congenital heart disease antenatally, just doing a simple karyotyping and ruling out Down syndrome is not enough. You have to think about even the other group of genetic conditions. So same holds true for various other scan abnormalities. So various different scan abnormalities can be associated with chromosomal abnormalities, can be associated with microdeletion, microduplication syndromes, or could be part of a single gene disorder. And it is important not to miss any of these, because most of the genetic conditions are associated with intellectual disability postnatally. So even if the scan is showing an isolated malformation, then also, and it is a treatable malformation, then also there is a possibility that there could be an underlying genetic condition in that baby, and which is not a karyotypic abnormality or not a chromosomal abnormality. And this baby tomorrow may be born with a single gene disorder and may have intellectual disability and other problems. And the other important point is that there is a high recurrence risk in single gene disorders. So it's important to diagnose this not only for this pregnancy, but even for subsequent pregnancy. So just to take through some other case scenarios. So here we had a consanguineous couple whereby there was a previous abortion and the second baby actually was affected with corpusculosa agenesis, intellectual disability, failure to thrive, and hearing and vision deficits. And this child subsequently died without a specific diagnosis, and the couple had come to us in 17 weeks of pregnancy. So at 17 weeks, then this particular baby also showed signs of an evolving ventriculomegaly with slightly dangling appearance of the choroid plexus. So the karyotype was normal and a fetal MRI was planned, and this MRI again showed agenesis of corpus callosum. So agenesis of corpus callosum in 75% of cases, 70 to 75% cases, if it is isolated on scan, then the baby will have a good outcome or a normal outcome. But around 25 to 30% cases, the baby may have other condition, other associated problems, and maybe intellectually handicapped postnatally. And this is one such situation where we already have a precedent in the form of a previous sibling who had corpus callosum agenesis and who had so many issues and subsequently died also. So in this family, we were able to counsel them that this is most likely going to be a poor prognosis situation. They terminated the pregnancy, and then the baby again on autopsy did not show anything else except for agenesis of corpus callosum. But in histopathology, we were able to show some abnormal cortical layering in the cerebrum. So in this situation, now we were left with a fetus who is having corpus callosum agenesis, some problems in the brain layers formation, and with a positive family history in form of consanguineous parents and a previous similarly affected sibling. So again, we are thinking of autosomal recessive condition. But then there is no single genetic disease which can explain this kind of presentation. So unlike what we saw in the case of congenital adrenal hyperplasia or DMD, where we had a working diagnosis, where looking at the clinical picture or other parameters, we knew that most likely this is a single diagnosis, and we were able to do targeted testing of that particular disease by sequencing or by doing MLP of that particular gene. Here, it's not possible. Corpus callosum agenesis can be part of so many different single gene disorders. So what do we do? So here, technology basically helps us. So now technology has evolved so much that we have something called as next generation sequencing, whereby we are able to do sequencing of all the genes in the genome. So where instead of doing it for one gene only, we can do it for all the genes together. So where we don't have a single clinical diagnosis, where we want to look at all the genes, we use this technique called as next generation sequencing. And the in under this, the test which is commonly used is called as exome sequencing. So just to kind of explain the test in a way, so when we were looking at chromosomal disorder, so by doing a karyotype, so this was trying to look at a zoomed out view of my city, that's Hyderabad, whereby you would just maybe see one or two few landmarks and that's it. You won't see any of the details. So that's kind of the resolution of a karyotype. We look at a chromosome and we are looking at any gross abnormalities in the chromosome. Whereas when we are doing microarray or when we are doing FISH, then in those cases, we are able to look at some landmarks in much detail. So we some certain areas we can focus on and we can look at them in more detail or we kind of zoom in a bit. So whereas when we are trying to look at only one gene in much detail, we really want to see that gene completely. So that's what we are doing when we are doing a Sanger sequencing. So here we can see the famous Charminar of Hyderabad. So that's a really zoomed in view. So whereas when we do exome sequencing, so here what we are doing is that we are actually, as I said, sequencing all of the genomic DNA. Mainly when we do exome sequencing, we are sequencing this coding part of the DNA or all the genes in the DNA. So here it's like kind of putting in Google Earth, putting in a little zoomed out view also. So basically we are looking at the whole of your coding part of your DNA in much detail. So you can see even the details also, and you can see much wider also. So that's a kind of a view which exome sequencing gives us. And in this particular case, that is what solved this case. So when we did this, we were able to find that this fetus was actually homozygous for a mutation in this EPG5 gene. And this mutations in this gene cause a condition called as Wicki syndrome, which has corpus callosum agenesis and all the other clinical features which the previous baby had. So again, this is an autosomal recessive condition with a recurrence risk of 25%. And we were able to do prenatal testing for this couple and they have a healthy baby now. And this I've already covered. So just another scenario whereby we had Leiker abnormalities as a presentation. Two pregnancies, both of them affected with very relatively early onset severe oligohydramnios and hydramnios kind of picture. Again, the second pregnancy terminated. The baby did not have any significant autopsy finding and there were unfortunately autolytic changes in the organ. So we're not able to see the kidneys properly. Karyotype was normal. We thought that this is some autosomal recessive condition causing a renal problem. And when we did again exome sequencing here, we found that the baby was having a mutation in the ACE gene, which is known to cause autosomal recessive renal tubular dysgenesis. And we did prenatal in the next pregnancy. And this is the photograph with the father sent us through WhatsApp after birth of this particular baby. So again, even in something like a Leiker abnormality, if it is recurrent, unexplained, we should again think of single gene disorders. So in fact, there have been in recent years, last few 4 or 5 years, many studies where people have now started to look for single gene disorders in case of abnormal ultrasound findings. And they find that at least 20-30% of such fetuses may be affected with these monogenic or single gene disorders. And these are important, as I explained earlier, because these babies can subsequently have other issues. And also because there is a recurrence risk even in subsequent pregnancies of this couple. And identifying these single gene disorders in case of abnormal scan findings helps us in taking, in counseling the parents regarding prognosis so that they can take decision regarding pregnancy continuation or termination or decisions regarding neonatal management. And also recurrence risk counseling and better testing for subsequent pregnancies. So we even have society guidelines now which say that in certain specific situation, we can use this advanced technology of exome sequencing for the purpose of workup when you have an abnormal scan findings. But this should always be done in consultation with a clinical genetics professional. So just the last scenario whereby you could have recurrent pregnancy loss or a bad obstetric history. This again is a very common referral reason for referral to our clinic. So this was again a consanguineous couple with multiple pregnancy losses three were first trimester losses, but the interesting one was this first one, an unexplained IUD at 23 weeks. And now again at 14 weeks, she had an IUD. And here also the fetus showed high drops. And when the baby was brought for autopsy, there was some subtle dysmorphism. But what was interesting was the cardiac finding in this particular baby. So this baby had a very rudimentary right ventricle and a narrow right outflow tract also, with the presence of this nubbin-like appearance on the right ventricle. So basically, it was kind of a hypoplastic right heart. And here, the microarray of the baby was normal, but because we were again suspecting single gene disorder because of the first pregnancy ending in an unexplained IUD, the parents being consanguineous. So we went ahead and we did exome sequencing on this fetus. And this fetus was found to be homozygous for mutations in this PLD1 gene. And this is actually known to cause a right heart outflow tract abnormality. So this was consistent with the phenotype. Both parents were carriers for this particular variant. And we are again able to counsel them appropriately. So in situations of recurrent pregnancy losses, bad obstetric history, chromosomal abnormalities is one important group of genetic disorder which we should not forget. So we should always do karyotype of the couple. But in addition, we should also think of single gene disorders. And for this, it is important that whenever there is a pregnancy loss beyond 12 weeks, so before 12 weeks, usually chromosomal disorders will predominate as the cause. Whereas after 12 weeks, you can have both chromosomal disorders as well as single gene disorders causing the pregnancy loss. So it's important always to do an autopsy whenever there is a pregnancy loss beyond 12 weeks, even if it is the only pregnancy loss. And if you cannot do an autopsy or there's no facility, you can at least take photographs, radiographs of the baby, preserve the clinical records and your findings properly, and very importantly, do a DNA banking. So DNA banking is very simple. If done antenatally, you can do amniocentesis, but otherwise also after birth of the baby, if it's a larger baby, you can collect cord blood. Otherwise, a skin biopsy or an umbilical cord segment can be collected from any gestation baby. And these can just be stored in the freezer for long term. And then ideally, you could immediately give the fresh tissue to a lab and they can extract the DNA and store the DNA so that later on a testing can be done on this particular sample. And the genetic testing again will depend a lot upon your clinical information, because it's a clinical information which helps us in deciding which test to do and how to interpret the test results. So similar to a pregnancy loss, we can sometimes have a genetic disease presenting as neonatal loss. So here, this was a consanguineous couple who had multiple neonatal deaths. And now again, their fourth baby also was admitted in a critical neonatal unit. And this baby was also very sick, had an encephalopathy kind of picture. And the father had just come to us with a blood sample of the baby, blood and urine sample of the baby. That's all we had. So at this particular time, the urine was normal, the acid-base gas analysis was normal, but the HPLC for amino acids on the blood sample of the baby showed elevated glycine levels. So this kind of picture actually suggests a specific genetic condition called as non-ketotic hyperglycemia. So this was what the clinical diagnosis was suspected, but unfortunately we could not get DNA of the baby and the baby died. But this condition is again an autosomal recessive condition. So the parents would be obligate carriers. So an autosomal recessive condition happens, as we saw initially, when both parents are having 1-1 mutation. So they are both carriers. So what we did was that we did sequencing of the parents. So this mutation, this particular disease is caused most commonly by mutations in this gene, GLDC. So we sequenced the parents' GLDC gene and we were able to find the mutation in both of them. And then on basis of this, we were able to provide prenatal testing in their next pregnancy, and they have a healthy female child now from this pregnancy. So even for neonatal deaths, it's important that many of these could be because of genetic conditions. And a large category of genetic conditions presenting like this are the inborn error of metabolism. And or it could sometimes be things like skeletal dysplasia or some lethal genetic syndromes. So always, again, here also, just like a pregnancy loss, here also it's important to take photos, to take x-rays, to record your clinical findings, and ideally do an autopsy to get a kind of a clinical diagnosis for that baby, and also to preserve the samples of the neonate. So neonate, any blood sample in 2 ml blood sample in the EGTA tube is all that is needed to do a DNA based testing. So besides all this, where we have already had mishaps happen for couples, there is something else which is obstetricians you can do, and this is much more in a way impactful, because it helps in primary prevention. Whatever we were doing, whatever scenarios I've shown till now, is mostly secondary prevention. We already have an affected person in the family, and then we are trying to prevent it from happening again. But we can also do a primary prevention for single gene disorders. This is not possible mostly for all conditions that much, but at least for some common conditions, this can be done. So, and mostly it is more feasible for the autosomal recessive condition. So one of the common autosomal recessive condition in our country is thalassemia. So in India, the carrier frequency of thalassemia is 3 to 17%. So on average, we can take 10%. So in a room of 100 people, so today we have probably 80, 90 attendees. So in this room itself, there would be around 10 people who would be thalassemia carriers, and they would be completely asymptomatic and they would not be knowing about it. And because the carrier frequency is so high in our country, two carriers may get married to each other just by chance. Even if they are not related, they are not consanguineous, two unrelated people may be carriers of thalassemia. And when such two unrelated people, for example, shown here in this box, they get married to each other, then in each of their pregnancy, there is a 25% chance that their child would have a transfusion-dependent beta thalassemia. So this can easily be prevented. We can do carrier testing of people who are planning a pregnancy by a simple biochemical test called as high-performance liquid chromatography. And we look at this HbA2 levels. Anything more than 3.5% indicates that a person is thalassemia carrier. So once we identify that one partner is carrier, we test the other partner. When both are carriers, then we have to first find the mutation of thalassemia by doing Sanger sequencing in them. And then once we know this, then we can offer them prenatal testing. So finally, to conclude my presentation, so we need to remember that genetic conditions, especially like the single gene disorder, they can have varied presentation. They can present across different time frames in the reproductive life of a lady. And as an obstetrician gynecology specialist, you have the opportunity to actually give both primary and secondary prevention to your patients. And in fact, you are the first point of contact for so many people who are planning a baby, and you're the one who can actually decrease the incidence of genetic conditions by being more aware and by referring these patients in a timely manner to a genetic specialist. And by be aware of these various situations, and then to kind of be able to identify these individuals and families who may be at risk of genetic condition, and refer them for appropriate testing, which is not just a karyotype, which is much, much beyond a karyotype. And for this, you may need to refer them to a genetic specialist so that the appropriate test can be chosen for your patient, because the test may also differ depending on the condition. And finally, it's important to make this diagnosis because it helps in management of the patient, in counseling the family regarding recurrence risk, and for offering them prenatal or pre-implantation genetic testing. And whenever there's a family history, it's very important that the affected person should first get worked up, and we should have a diagnosis of that affected person. Then only we can find out the carriers in the family and we can do any further testing. And preconception period is the best time for doing this workup. Often we have patients coming to us in 20 weeks of pregnancy, and they have a family history of somebody affected with a genetic condition, and they are referred directly at 20 weeks for amniocentesis. This cannot be done. It's not possible to offer prenatal testing for some condition in the family without having any workup. So important thing is to refer these patients in the preconception period or early prenatal period, so that we can first complete the workup of the proband that is the affected person. So once we complete the workup of the affected person, because that itself may take sometimes 1 to 3 months So depending on what is the diagnosis, what are the tests we are doing, so that there is a time limit, time concern there. So this kind of workups have to be done in the preconception or the early prenatal period, not at the time of whenever you are at the last limit of prenatal testing. And it's important to store records, photos, samples whenever you are faced with the situation of a pregnancy loss and early neonatal loss. And as we saw, new technologies like exome sequencing now can in fact help us in cases where we were not able to have any answers in the past. So I think with this, I'll end.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shagun, for that engaging talk. I now invite the audience for any questions or comments in the Q&A window. Maybe Dr. Mandakini, would you like to add something, madam?
Joseph?
Yes, ma'am.
I think our beginning is little this thing, without any questions.
Okay.
Surprising.
Yes, it is.
All understood, nothing understood.
Everything understood, ma'am.
Everything understood, very positive.
Yes.
So that is great. That is great. And but then because we will continue and Joseph has got the email address of all attendees, then all attendees are requested that if you have any doubt in your clinical practice, day-to-day practice also, you please pass on the questions so that we can be able to answer from the experts. So I must thank,
One moment. I think Joseph, there is one person who's raised her hand.
Okay.
Maybe they can type it out in the Q&A window. So that is open for question and answer. I've also engaged the chat window. So if anybody has any Q&A there also, they can.
Dr. Lekha Bansal.
Yeah, Dr. Chitralekha Bansal.
Maybe you can enable their mic, Joseph. I mean, if she wants to ask. She doesn't. Okay. I think somebody has asked about MLPA, I think.
Yeah, I think we have a question here. Oh, it's just a... They need the recording.
So I'll just answer this one.
Am I
audible?
Dr. Kumudini, this is called MLPA. So hope that is what you are asking about, and it is definitely not LMP, last menstrual period. So naturally it will be MLPA only, and Dr. Sagun can answer. Yeah. Dr. Sagun,
So MLPA is actually, yes, ma'am. So MLPA is actually, it's a short form, it's an acronym. So it is multiplex ligation dependent probe amplification. So that's the complete name of the test. So this is a kind of a special PCR, which we do to look for a particular type of genetic defects. So here we are looking at deletions or duplications. So deletions and duplications, which are involving like certain regions of the genome. And these regions are like, they are not big enough to be seen under karyotype. And these deleted or duplicated regions may range from maybe few KBs in size, like kilobases in size, to little bit larger size also, few megabases also. So here we do a special type of PCRs, and I don't want to go into the technicalities. Maybe you'll not, I mean, it's difficult to kind of, for you to grasp also probably, but we just do this special type of PCR whereby we can look for these kind of deletions and duplications involving a particular gene. Like for example, if we are doing in case of DMD, same thing, same technology we can use for another genetic condition called as spinal muscular atrophy, or we can use even for another type of thalassemia called as alpha thalassemia. So here in all these situations, we use this technique MLPA to look for deletions and duplications in that gene. And same technique can also be used for, in fact, to look for micro deletions also. So like if we were thinking like something kind of Diazot syndrome, so a small deletion involving the 22nd chromosome, that deletion, to pick that up, again, karyotype is not good enough. Previously, we used to use FISH. Now what we can use is MLPA. FISH can also be used, but FISH is little labor intensive and more expensive. Whereas we can use MLPA to same pick up that large deletion also, which causes Diazot syndrome. And in that same experiment, we can even look for other micro deletions and duplications. So that is another beauty of MLPA compared to FISH.
Yeah,
when
Dr.
we are
Sagun.
Looking for micro deletions.
Yeah, Dr. Sagun, somebody is asking. Somebody is asking if MLPA can detect point mutation.
Point mutations. No, so MLPA cannot detect point mutations. MLPA is mainly meant for detecting larger deletions and duplications only. It's not the test for point mutations. If we want to look for point mutations, we have to do sequencing.
Yeah. And Dr. Kamal Patil is asking how many mutations of beta thalassemia are there in India, and can all beta thalassemia mutations be diagnosed? Yes.
Yes. So definitely, I mean, in India, we have more than, I think, maybe some 100 to 200 mutations are there. But there are certain common mutations which compromise around 95% of thalassemia patients. So that is a little bit different across different parts of India. So in North India, there are some 5 common mutations. So 95% of thalassemia patients would be having those 5 mutations. Same in South India, we have a certain another group of 5 common mutations. So, but overall, there can be many hundreds of mutations in the thalassemia gene. But as I said, 95% of patients would have some common mutations. So when we do testing for thalassemia, previously the techniques which were used were more targeted towards detecting these common mutations. So we had some older techniques called as dot blot or reverse dot blot techniques and all, and even a technique called as arms PCR. So these techniques mainly we used to look for only the common mutations, because we knew that 95% patients will have those common mutations. But now the technique which most labs use is Sanger sequencing. So in sequencing, you are actually reading the whole of the thalassemia gene, which is the beta thalassemia gene. So you are checking the sequence of the whole of the thalassemia gene. So when you're checking the sequence of the whole gene, you will pick up all the mutations of thalassemia. So now it's possible by using sequencing. So you have to make sure that the lab, suppose you're referring a patient and you're suspecting thalassemia and the patient's report comes negative, cross-check with the lab what technique they're using. If they're using sequencing, then they should have picked up all the mutations. Then your diagnosis is probably something else. But if they have used dot blot or reverse dot blot or arms PCR, then maybe they have missed a mutation. Then you should be doing sequencing.
Before the next question, somebody is asking, Dr. Anjana is asking, how much karyotyping will be useful in common diseases like diabetes mellitus? Madam can answer. I think Dr. Ma'am can answer if karyotype will be useful for diabetes mellitus. Ma'am is connected, but muted. Yeah, Dr. Sagun, you can take it up.
Okay. So actually, diabetes mellitus is not per se a chromosomal disorder at all. So in diabetes mellitus, in most of the patients, it is not even a genetic condition. So most patients with diabetes mellitus, you may see a family history, but that family history is just like, it's what is called as a multifactorial disorder. So there may be some component of some genetic predisposition to diabetes, but it will not show inheritance pattern like autosomal dominant or inheritance kind of clear-cut inheritance. In fact, environment plays a very important role. So even if somebody is genetically predisposed to develop diabetes, unless the environmental factors like poor lifestyle and all is there, that person will not develop diabetes. So in most of the cases, diabetes is not a genetic condition. However, there are certain genetic types of diabetes, which are called as maturity onset diabetes of the young, where you do see autosomal dominant type of diabetes running in family. And usually diabetes onset at around 35 years or sometimes even younger than that. So, but those are very minor proportion of diabetes. Maybe around 5% of diabetic patients may be having this genetic type of diabetes. And that is also a single gene type. So in no situation would you have an abnormality in a chromosome resulting in diabetes. So there is absolutely no role of doing a karyotyping in diabetes.
And other common diseases like hypertension and things like that. So karyotype is not to be ordered in a patient of diabetes or hypertension. So please remember that. And Dr. Komadini Jha is asking if you have any clinical picture in RPL, that means recurrent pregnancy loss, from where do you start?
Sure, what does she mean?
It's difficult to comprehend what clinical picture in RPL. Do you mean that it is pedigree, drawing a pedigree?
Maybe I'll answer in general, ma'am. So any case with the RPL, so one thing always which is important, first thing, I mean, do you rule out the acquired causes? So that is the most important thing, because genetic causes will be relatively less frequent compared to the but then once you have ruled out all acquired etiologies, then we should be thinking of a genetic cause. In the genetic cause, again, doing chromosomal abnormalities would be more common, especially again in early pregnancy, first trimester losses. So the first thing to do would be karyotype of the parents. So that is the most important thing. But as I said that in my presentation also, but in certain situations, especially when you have second trimester or third trimester losses, and probably if they are, as you said, they are kind of when we should also think of single gene disorder. So you have ruled out acquired etiologies, you have ruled out chromosomal abnormality, then we start thinking of single gene disorders. And in such a situation, again, just working in the dark is almost impossible. So it is best to have an autopsy of the pregnant, the conceptors. So, on the basis of autopsy, often we will be able to make a specific diagnosis. Sometimes it may be a lethal skeletal dysplasia, or it could be some other genetic syndrome like Meckel-Gruber syndrome and all. So that could be causing. So by looking at the baby itself, we can make a clinical genetic diagnosis. And depending on that, then we can do the testing.
Yeah, Dr. Sargun, somebody is, some anonymous attendee is complimenting you. And is it possible to create a manual for ultrasound experts to give guidance as to ultrasound observation and clinical background, what tests to be done? We have not made it, but then there are guidelines whereby we decide which are the ultrasound factor and what tests to be done. And for general everyone to understand, is first test that we must do is karyotype. That is a basic test because it's the first step to enter into any genetic test. So that is any ultrasound abnormality, first you need to do a chromosomal analysis, and further testing is warranted if chromosome is abnormal. If it is abnormal, then you stop there. So first test to be ordered is a chromosomal analysis. So if it is normal, then only you go ahead and do further testing depending on the findings. So the findings, it varies from different findings. Suppose, say you are seeing a skeletal dysplasia, your next test may be different from what you are seeing if it is a syndrome or multiple abnormality. So that, and subsequent lectures, it will be more and more clearer also.
Yes, adding to that point, so we'll be covering some of these in more detail in the coming few weeks. So for the convenience of the audience, you can have a look at the date and timing will be the same. You can look at the topics that we'll be covering in more depth in the coming few weeks.
Oh, yes. And Dr. Shagun, can you summarize what is the difference uses of microRNA MLPA? Again, people have gone on to MLPA. We intentionally had kept it a little this thing so that there won't be any confusion. But then I understand that why this MLPA is coming up is many labs are providing it as a first line of investigation. So can you tell them what is the uses of microRNA and what are the uses of MLPA?
So microRNA actually is, it's a kind of a genome-wide technique in the sense that using microRNA, we can actually look for deletion and duplication anywhere in the DNA. So it's like a multiple, like if you want to look at deletions anywhere in the chromosome 1. So microRNA can check for that. Same all the, across all the chromosomes, it will be able to tell whether there is a deletion or duplication. So it's kind of a genome-wide technique. And you can even, where you don't have a clinical suspicion of a particular deletion or duplication, there also microRNA will be able to give you an answer. Whereas when we are talking about MLPA, so MLPA is usually like one of the indications what I told you was for diagnosis of some single gene disorders like DMD. The case we saw, or spinal muscular atrophy or alpha thalassemia. These are single gene disorders. So one utility of MLPA is for this. But when we are using MLPA for microdeletions in microdeletion or microduplication syndromes like Dijot syndrome, that being one example. So in such cases, MLPA can only check for some known syndromes. So there are certain well-defined microdeletion syndromes. So Dijot syndrome is one example where there is a deletion in 22nd chromosome. Then there is there are other conditions called as Prader-Willi syndrome and Angelman syndrome, which are caused by deletion in the 15th chromosome. Then we have a Williams syndrome, which is by deletion in the 7th chromosome. So like that, there are some few microdeletion syndromes where we already know the diagnosis. We are seeing the patient in front of us and we are suspecting that this is Williams syndrome or this is Dijot syndrome. So MLPA can only check for those specific known microdeletion conditions, because in one experiment, you will be able to get some 10 microdeletion syndromes. Only you will get the answer regarding those 10 only. And those 10 also, we already have the reagents designed in such a way that they will look for only those 10 conditions. It will not tell you anything beyond that. Whereas a microRNA can tell you that there can be a deletion or duplication anywhere in the genome, in any of the chromosomes, it will tell you, even if you don't have a specific clinical diagnosis. So
yes, very clear. So hope this is clear to everyone that microRNA is something which looks into the whole of the genome. That means the whole of the chromosomes, that is from 1 to 23 pairs. Whereas MLPA is specific for that disease. So we identify the disease and then order for MLPA. So these are two absolutely different things. So do not confuse between microRNA and MLPA. So the probes are designed in such a way that it will look into one condition only. So we had nice interaction and we had excellent presentation. So I thank, do you have specific what diseases you are looking for in MLPA? Do you have to specify? Yes. Dr. Rajiv Dhal is asking. Dr. Rajiv has connected. Nice. So he is one of those very regular this thing of our genetic program. So do you have to specify what disease you are looking for in MLPA? Yes, you need to specify which disease you are looking for. Unless you are doing subtelomeric this thing for mental retardation, nobody is doing now. So so you need to specify it. So I thank Dr. Shagun also on my behalf and on Foxy Genetics and Fetal Medicine Committee chairperson. And I am really happy that Dr. Hema Purandare could make it. I wanted her to be there. She is the one who started genetics in India. She is the one who, seeing whom we probably took up. And we look forward to people like this who started this thing. And anything else? And we look forward for subsequent, this thing will address the basic genetics. Then we'll move on to clinical genetics. So there are some overlap of each other, but then still this thing, Joseph?
Yes, ma'am.
There have to have some overlap and more clarification as we go progress on.
Surely, surely. Yeah. So this is our plan for the coming few weeks. So next week, of course, is a festival week. So we won't be having anything next week. So the week after that, we'll be having clinical genetics, where we'll be looking at family history and preconceptional and prenatal counseling. And we have an excellent speakers lined up for the subsequent sessions also. So the audience can take a note of the date. The timing will be the same. And we will be sending out invites for this just a few days before the talks. So you can look out for that in your email. Ma'am, you're on mute, ma'am.
And I thank all the audience to be present here, to be connected with this program. And you can send on to your friends who are a little interested in understanding what is this genetics going on. So thank you all.
Yeah, thank you very much from MedGenome to Dr. Mandakini for providing us this opportunity to conduct this series in association with FOGSI, and look forward to the next sessions. And thank you again to Dr. Shagun Agarwal and also to Dr. Hima Purandare for taking time off from their busy schedules for give us these interesting talks. So thank you, everyone, and have a nice day ahead.
And thank you, Dr. Priya. Bye-bye.
Thank you. No, I mean, we had both the sessions were so good, very, very excellent, very beautifully. I mean, we can actually see the great experience that both these speakers have, and very, very useful for everybody else. Very great start to the session.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah.